Hello, once again, we're at the home of Jerome Marcus, and we are indeed privileged to have Mel Gaynor of Simple Minds with us. Mel, thanks for coming to chat to us.
You're welcome.
We're also interrupting a drum lesson being hosted by Sam Kelly in the studio there, so if you hear some drumming coming through, that's got to be a good thing. Mel, 30 years with Simple Minds, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, it's actually 32 years.
32 years?
From this year, yeah. It's, I guess, a big celebration for us. But
I mean, touring, obviously, recording, all that kind of thing. Anything mad, bad or dangerous about that?
Oh, lots. Lots. I could probably start off with one story about when I was on a very early tour in the 80s. Usually when I stand up and play at the start of the gig, stand up and get the audience participation, my roadie, he usually takes the stool away from me. So I got more room to manoeuvre. And on this occasion, he was otherwise engaged, let's say, and he forgot to put the stool back.
Oh,
so
dear.
I went legs akimbo, and the keyboard player was howling with laughter, and there was no beat.
Did you fall back off the riser?
No, fortunately not. Just on the riser, but the legs were in the air.
But the crowd must have seen you legs in the air. Do you know what it was he was doing? Well, would you rather not say?
I knew exactly what he was doing, but on camera, I can't.
On camera, very sensible. Drummers in general. I mean, are we bonkers?
Do you know what? I believe we're the sanest of the band, and I think the person to be completely bonkers is always a bass player, in my opinion, because every bass player I've met has got a screw loose. It's definitely got a screw loose. Every single one, even though they seem sane, when they go out on the road and you spend more time with them, they're crazy. And if you look at it within a rhythm section or within a band, the drummers are always the stable ones. They're the ones who are holding the beat.
They're keeping everything together.
Exactly.
The engine room, all that sort
of
thing.
Exactly, engine room. So
because it's such a therapeutic thing to do, presumably you're going to be the sanest because you're getting all your angst out of you while playing the drums.
Absolutely. And, you know, although there's been many drummers that have been, I guess, wildly misusing drugs or been alcoholics, they seem to still have the ability to play even when they're under the influence.
Yeah. Have you had to do that before?
Never. I mean, I've never indulged in anything on stage. You know, I've always been straight on stage.
Yeah.
And it surprises me how drummers can actually be wasted on stage. Because it is such a physical sport, if you like.
Absolutely. I read recently that apparently to play a 3-hour gig as a drummer, you need to be as fit as a marathon runner.
That's right. Or a footballer as well.
Yeah.
It's been equal to footballing as
well. Also, in terms of the mentality, apparently we're more intelligent. I don't know where that survey was done.
I don't know
what university it was.
I'd love to know where that came from. But no, I mean, there is an intelligence with drummers because they're the person who has a responsibility.
Yeah.
Certainly with me, I mean, on stage, we have this thing which we call a tank, a multi-track sequencing system. And quite a lot of the set is down to, you know, extra sequencing, which relies on the drummer to start.
Because that's not easy to do, is it? I mean, if you're playing live and you're playing to sequences like click tracks or whatever, and then the sequence goes out for a while and then comes back in again, and if you're in control of all that, then you've got to be able to think quickly.
And
you've got
absolutely and savvy. Yeah, I mean, a lot of the drummers now get into sequencing, get into computer programming, get into you know, Pro Tools and Logic and whatever else there is available.
And talking about getting into drums, I mean, I spent a lot of time when I was about 11 staring through a shop called Hammond's Music Store in Watford.
Okay.
Which used to make a lot of, strangely enough, organs and keyboards and stuff, but they sold loads of drums at one time. And I used to spend ages just looking through the windows at these different coloured
drums. Funny enough, I used to play with the bass player who used to run Hammond's.
Not Bob Morledge.
Yeah, the big guy.
Yeah, it's Bob Morledge.
Yeah, Bob Morledge, yeah.
He's still doing it.
God.
Yeah, he's still playing.
Unbelievable. Yeah. Unbelievable.
Yeah, I've encountered him now and again. We've been in bands together before on you know, Depths and Sessions and stuff.
But I used to play with him in the Flirtations.
I had a single by them. My dad bought me it because he was in advertising once upon a time and he met them and he bought me back that single. Okay. I think it was the B-side was If I Had a Love.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
Gracious me.
Inside, yeah. So I was one of my first bands.
Yeah. Gracious me, what coincidence. Okay. I used to look at these drum kits, sort of, you know, in awe of them. And was there anything in particular that inspired you to become a drummer?
Well, Buddy Rich was one of my biggest heroes. Billy Cobham, John Bonham.
Yeah.
So all the greats. And what actually inspired me was to go to Drum City, which is in Tottenham Court Road.
Yes, I remember it.
And also to Henricks, which is around the corner.
Bob Henricks' store,
yeah. Which is a great store. But Drum City was the one. And I used to salivate over Premier kits and in the window. And I always wanted to play a Premier kit. And I ended up meeting George Fredericks and joined Premier at an early age.
Do you use Premier now?
No, I don't, no. I'm actually using a drum called Dixon.
Oh.
And Dixon were responsible for making a lot of the Yamaha shells, which I didn't know that.
Yeah. But in terms of the lifestyle of a drummer, touring, that sort of thing, spending half your time around the world and whatever, not being at home, how easy do you think it is to maintain relationships and that sort of thing?
Very difficult.
Yeah.
Very difficult. It depends on how old you are.
Yeah.
I guess the young touring drummers, I would say it's pretty much impossible.
When you get older, you get to decide more.
I guess when you're older, you obviously you're more responsible.
Yeah.
So I've kind of been through the two sides of this. But I think really to hold a relationship in music is your only stability, really.
Yeah.
If you have this thing of going on stage and being a superstar and then coming off stage and being a normal dad, husband,
yeah,
I think that's a great thing.
Yeah.
And I think it's a balance to keep yourself in check.
You can achieve a very healthy balance in that.
You can, yeah. But I think if you don't maintain that balance and you're living the high life all the time,
yeah,
I think it's very dangerous.
Yeah.
Very dangerous. And you can do that easily these days.
Do you ever get the panics on stage?
I think the only thing I've had is mind lapse.
Yeah.
And probably thinking about other things, you know, thinking about, you know, what you're going to have for dinner or, and you suddenly miss a beat and you think, oh, crap.
Have you ever played when you're really sick or injured?
Yes, I have. There was actually one time in Spain where I had kidney stones. I actually was diagnosed this in the afternoon.
Yeah.
And I was in great agony, great pain. And I thought, well, I better go on and do the gig. I think halfway through and I collapsed.
Halfway through the gig?
Yep. So I had to get taken off, dragged to the hospital. That was a big, 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 big shock for me. Because in fact, the second time that I had to cancel a gig, the first time was where I was coming out of a van. Seems funny now. Coming out of a van and I gripped the middle pole coming out of a van, and the bright tour manager decided to close the door onto my hand. So it trapped my hand right in the middle of the door.
Ooh.
And I didn't realize it. I was in so much shock. Then I started to scream and he opened the door and the blood gushed out or whatever else. But he managed to destroy a tendon in my finger. So what I had to do was I didn't get the chance to get it stitched up. I had it, I had to get it bandaged up. But again, the pain was too intense on the stage for me to continue. So that was about 50 minutes into the gig.
Good God. So I bet he got a bit of a telling off.
Yeah.
Talking of people like that, how important is the drum tech, would you say?
Oh, very important. Yeah. I mean, he's my lifesaver. You know, his name is Derek Patterson.
Yeah.
He's been with me for about 15 years now.
Yeah.
He's great. You know, he's very attentive. Anything that I need or want, he preempts that. And he also does my sound as well, which is quite unusual. So I have to carry my own mixer.
Yeah.
So he's invaluable.
What's the strangest thing that's happened to you as a drummer?
The strangest thing was actually turning up at a gig and seeing my old drum kit. Somebody had bought my drum kit from ages and ages ago. And I saw it at a gig and I thought, I recognise that kit. And it was actually my kit.
Did you know the person who was playing it, or was it?
No, I didn't.
Had it gone on through several ownerships since?
It went through several. Several, you know.
Yeah. Did you tell him? Did you tell him?
Yeah, that was my drum kit. I said that was my old drum kit, and he's like, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Yeah, it's my old drum kit." Yeah, it was a Black Shadow actually. Premier Black Shadow.
So if I say to you, what, five drummers?
Oh, that's a difficult one. In order.
No, I won't be that cruel.
Okay, Narada Michael Walden is one. Yeah. Billy Cobham is another. Steve Gadd.
Yeah.
Tony Williams. Who'd be the other one? I guess Buddy Rich.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be the top five.
Do you like listening to Ringo?
Yeah, Ringo was great. Right. Even Charlie Watts, he's got his own style.
He's the only one for the Stones, isn't he?
Yeah. Although I could definitely think of a replacement.
Oh, right.
That'd be Steve Jordan. He'd be perfect for the Stones.
So what's been your highest moment, you reckon, playing the drums?
Well, there's quite a few, I'd say, but I think one of the highest is playing Live Aid.
Yeah.
That was a real buzz.
Yeah.
After being locked in the studio for the best part of 3 months, recording the album. Yeah. And it was a real high moment.
Do you still party at all afterwards, or are those days over?
Do you know what? We don't party, no. I mean, we'd probably rather do the Times crossword.
What about the fraternity of drummers? I mean, it seems that when drummers get together, there's always a pretty good atmosphere.
I would say that there's less ego in drumming.
There never seems to be this sort of thing where, you know, the drummers are trying to play faster fills than the next one.
What well, I don't know about that. If you're at a drummer's meeting, or a drum clinic.
Oh, there's a lot of that sort of going on.
There's a lot of playoffs.
Yeah. But when it's not happening, people are chatting. No one says, I'm faster than you or anything like that.
Well, I don't think they say it, but
they're probably thinking it. Do you rehearse at all on your own, I mean?
To be quite honest, I don't really get the time to do that.
Yeah.
So I kind of, you know, all new chops will be tested at the sound check.
Yeah.
Or something like that. But no, I prefer to play with other people.
Do you ever get this thing that it's sometimes good to get away from the drums so that when you've had a break, say on holiday or something, when you come back, it just feels
it's
really
refreshed.
Good.
Yeah,
it just feels really great.
Absolutely.
But it's nice not to play them for a while as
absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely, yeah, it is. It's a great thing to have the break. I mean, there's certain drummers that I know that don't have a break. You know, they're 24/7 into technique, into rehearsing, into practicing, which I guess if you don't have a life apart from your instrument,
you might be a bit mad.
Exactly, I think so.
Do you like recording or playing live? Which for you is the best experience?
Both.
Both. Yeah.
I love it both.
Yeah. And what are Simple Minds doing at the moment?
We're back in the studio.
Yeah.
So we're in the studio to record a new album.
Yeah.
And then we undertake a tour in October, starting in Brazil.
Are the tours shorter these days than they used to be?
Do you know what? Yeah, they are. I mean, they're shorter bursts.
Yeah.
You know, we have like a two and a half month burst.
Yeah.
And then, you know, 2 months off.
Does that work better for you, do you think?
Sometimes it's good. It's good to be back home and it's good to fly out.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you get itchy feet, you go and do something. But, the tours are getting shorter. It's strange you should say that, yeah.
How long did it take for you to stop being a drummer and become a musician?
Well, that's quite a tricky question. I think you start to become a musician when you start to listen to the song, as opposed to listening to yourself.
What do you reckon it is that drives people to become a successful musician?
Well, I think anything you want to achieve, you have to do it 100%, or 1,000,000%, I'd say.
Yeah.
Because if you don't involve yourself or immerse yourself within what you're doing, you're not going to achieve it.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the way I joined Simple Minds was purely a session.
Yeah.
I got approached while I was actually doing the Heatwave session by a producer called Pete Walsh.
Yeah.
And he said he's got a new band called Simple Minds from Scotland. I was like, Simple who? And he said, yeah, now come and check them out and, you know, see if you like playing with them. At the time, they had a drummer, another drummer. So I stepped in to replace this drummer who's having problems playing with a click track.
Yeah.
And I ended up joining the band.
And so that was like a kind of a...
So if I hadn't been in that place at the right time, playing that session, linking up with that producer...
Yeah. 32 years you've been in Simple Minds. What's it like being in the same band for that period of time? Is it like coming home every time?
Kind of. It is a family atmosphere.
Are you glad it worked out that way?
Well, I think playing in different bands over the different years, I think you become quite stagnated in a way, because you're treated as a session musician and not as a band member.
Yeah.
You're dipping your toe in different waters, but you're not actually part of that unit. So it's great to have an identity within a unit.
Yeah. What's your typical way of relaxing, say, you know, hotel, that sort of thing. There's nowhere near showtime.
See the city. You know, if we've got a couple of days there, we like to see the city.
Yeah.
I mean, the actual performance is probably 20% of what we do. The rest is travelling.
Yeah.
And travelling takes its toll.
And the guys all still getting on?
Yeah,
like a good
we get on well. There's always sometimes fallouts, you know.
Yeah.
But no, majority of the time we get on well.
And how many are on tour with you these days? I mean, crew-wise.
It depends on the tour. You know, if we take our own production out,
it's
usually about 40 people, 45 people.
Yeah.
If we're on a festival, it's probably about 10 people.
So, what else are you doing outside Simple Minds?
Well, I've got my band called The Fusion Project, which is a jazz fusion band.
Yeah.
We've had two albums out, and we're looking to bring a third album out pretty shortly.
Yeah.
I'm currently building a studio as well.
Yeah.
And I've got a third project, which is called BBMG, which is a three-piece rock band.
All right.
Of which I'm singing and playing the drums.
At the same time, I take it.
At the same time, so that can be checked out on YouTube or whatever. Plus, on top of that, masterclasses and clinics.
Yeah, and do you teach on a regular basis as well?
I don't, not as regular as I'd like.
Yeah.
I guess, again, it's time permitting, but I'd like to teach more.
Yeah.
And eventually start my own school.
Right,
so that's something I'd like to do in the future.
Mel, Mad, Bad and Dangerous, what do you reckon?
Well, it's a great book, it's well written, and
thank you.
It's an interesting analogy of drummers' experiences, and I hope I can give a few more.
Well, if we do another one, would you like to?
Yes, I'd love to. I'd love to.
Cheers, Mel. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you.
Great, great product.
Thank you. And then we didn't see him again for 7 years. Can you imagine that? Oh, hi. Hope you enjoyed the interview with Mel. If you haven't seen our interview with Kevin Morris from Dr. Feelgood, check out the previous videos button. And for all our videos, check out the more videos button. Next up is session legend Clem Cattini. Looking forward to that. By the way, did you hear the one about the drummer who had to... Hello, once again, we're at the home of... Hang on.
Cut.
Hi there, here we are again at... Oh, hang on.
Oh, you forgot my name.
I'm terrible like that. It's getting worse as I get older.
Every time.
Cut back into my first question, can't
That's fine. Between those.
That's great.
Okay. No, I'm just getting frostbite in this head.
That's right. How's it feel, Aaron? Stuck over there in the... He's stuck in the rain. Are they raining on you?
What we often do, if you don't mind, is we
having
one of you
like,
and I've got one in
here. It's like control problems here because I'm letting Aaron film the start and it's bothering me. He's going to beat me up.
Which is beautiful.
Okay. You can't relinquish control.
Russ Miller's just taking one as well.
You need a good shot. Yeah. Is this a good shot?
Let's see if we can get him to be quiet, shall we?
Sam? Hey, Sam, I'm trying to do an interview out here.
Listen
here, man!
Oh,
no,
sorry,
get your ass out of
here!
Come on!
Coming in like this.